Hey guys, sorry about that. Hey, hello everybody. So I got the camera going in a weird way. I want to just do a short little Periscope here about just the concept of dog training. I was actually doing, I'm doing some film editing right now. I'm just editing some film of this dog, Moxie. What happens is, Angela, can you just, I'm going to try to do a Periscope now. Yeah, but can you just keep it down for a little bit, just for a couple more minutes? Thank you so much, buddy. So I just want to show people the power of dog training. And when I see dogs like this that get transformed by my staff at the training center, I want folks to know that there's no like miraculous magic fairy dust, like wonderful thing happening other than consistency. And I've got a really talented staff. I'm not going to discount my staff. My staff is awesome. My staff is incredible. We've done this so many times, but I want to really just show people the process about how dogs that would be destined for death can dramatically change in about 10 days or less. And that's not working with these dogs for 8 hours a day. So this is a dog named Moxie. Moxie came in 2 weeks ago. But first, let me just turn this around and introduce myself. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. You can go to my website, Solid Canine Training. And by going to my website, you'll see everything we do. I'm down in Florida right now. I travel the world doing seminars. I've got an awesome staff. You're gonna see John, my head trainer, actually in this Periscope. And he runs the training program up in Providence, Rhode Island. What people can do is there's a little character in this corner. Click on the little character in the corner, and then you can share this on Facebook, share this on Twitter, and then you can also share this on Periscope. Also, join my Periscope, follow me on Periscope, and then turn on your alerts. I think this is my third or fourth Periscope of the day. When I woke up this morning, I had no idea what I was gonna do, and then I get ideas in the middle of the day to do it. Also, the reason why there's hearts there, because people are tapping their screen. So let me just show everybody a quick video. This is the dog on the intake. Let's watch that one more time, just the beginning of it. Okay. So just to let everybody know, this is typical of a dog we work with. So I like to scale things. So a lot of times when I give out advice about, you know, hey, you've got to correct the dog. Hey, you've got a relationship issue. Hey, don't let the dog get away with stuff. You'll understand why. Because these are dogs, that would be an average dog that we get in our training center. Now imagine that being a 100-pound Rottweiler. Imagine that being a very strong Pitty. Imagine that being a very large German Shepherd. So that's called resource guarding. Now, that dog is resource guarding a food bowl, but that dog resource guards everything. Dog bed, toys, space, anything it picks up. If it gets it and you want it, it does that. Okay? That's called resource guarding. So a lot of times when you read articles or you see postings about like, oh, if you give your dog enough love and affection and if you use positive reinforcement, you'll eliminate all those things. Okay? I want people to know that's an outright, blatant, unethical lie and an insult to a dog and an insult to a client. It's a fantasy land. Now, 90% of the work we do is quote unquote positive, but there's no such thing as positive reinforcement training. It's an impossibility. It's an impossibility. So, and I've got a $25,000 contest out there that says if anybody can rehab a dog like this with positive reinforcement training, I will give them $25,000. And I'm serious about that. It cannot be done. It cannot be done. Okay? So that's a typical dog. That dog did not get like that because it was abused. It wasn't hit. It didn't come from a dumpster. It didn't live in a shoebox. It wasn't hit by kids. It wasn't neglected. Okay, that's not how that dog got like that. How did that dog get like that? None of us know. Were any of us there? Did any of us raise that dog? Were we there from the minute of conception up until when that dog came into solid canine training? Nobody knows. We can make up anything we want, but nobody knows. Okay? I've had that challenge out there for a long time. It can't be done. It's impossible. And I'll tell you why. As soon as you put a leash on a dog, you're not doing positive reinforcement anymore. Now you're doing negative punishment. But I don't talk science. So what I want people to understand is, don't be swayed by catchphrases from people that are using big words to explain what they're doing. I will generalize that behavior. It's called being a major asshole. It's called a dangerous behavior that will get that dog killed. That's my scientific response to that dog's behavior. Okay? Now, our job is to rehab that dog that is brought to us. So somebody is paying us a large sum of money to rehabilitate that dog. So now we have an ethical responsibility as a professional dog trainer to rehabilitate that dog. If you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. And this is my website. There's a little character in the corner. Click on the little character. And I'm going to show you what we're doing today or yesterday. I'll show you the work that John is doing as of yesterday. Now, anytime you try to touch that dog, same reaction. Anytime you try to put a collar on that dog, any collar, a flat buckle collar, a slip lead, that reaction. Okay? So, watch this again. This is on the intake. Now my staff is holding that dog back. Good thing that the staff is holding that dog back because that dog would have bitten and made contact with my staff. Imagine a child walking by that dog, if it was playing with a toy, if it was chewing, eating its food, if it was chewing a bone, if it had a dog bed that it wanted to own. It's called resource guarding. The dog resource guarded everything. It was not just food. So I'm going to show you where we are today a little bit more than a week later. I want people to understand the power of training. I want people to understand why I'm have such a big mouth and I'm so loud and I can be very abrasive and I can challenge the status quo because I assure you that over 90% of dog trainers in the United States would recommend that dog to be killed. I assure you that's what would happen. And if somebody's gonna sit there on their high horse and say, no, if you do this, they might be true, but a lot of the things that we keep hearing won't work with this. Okay, why? So chances are I was not there. I'm in Florida. Chances are what they did with that dog on day two was they told that dog not to do it with a remote collar. We used a punisher. We corrected, punished, used an aversive to stop that dog cold in its tracks. We told that dog, you will not do that again, or a high level consequence will come down on it. How do we get it on? Probably muzzled it and probably had two staff members. Okay, and it might not have been pretty. These are the facts. Nobody hit the dog, nobody kicked the dog, but this is just the way it is. I assure you though, it was probably a lot less stressful than a dog that hates the vet being restrained by three vet techs. Nothing against vets, but all I know is if you talk to any vet tech or vet, sometimes it takes 2 or 3 vet techs to hold the dog down to take its temperature, to get a heart rate. The dog is muzzled. The anal glands are exploding. The dog is peeing and pooing on the table. Talk to any vet tech, any vet office. It happens on a daily basis. So chances are whatever we did is less stressful than that. I'm not saying vet techs are bad. Don't take it out of context, right? What I'm saying is we did what had to be done. Why? We are called professional dog trainers. We are paid a very large amount of money to get results. And let me show you where we are today. So I was editing a video, and before I even edited it, I wanted to just show everybody. So here's John working with this dog. Well, now that, remember, this is a dog we couldn't get a collar on. This is a dog who had intense energy around food and resources. Now, a lot of people say, oh, correcting a dog ruins the relationship. I want people to also know that that's a blatant, disrespectful lie. It's disrespectful to the human, it's disrespectful to the dog. And if a professional dog trainer or if a medical doctor, such as a vet, who is licensed with a degree and is overseen by a board, all right? A board is actually lying to you unethically and probably should lose their medical license because they're actually lying to a client. Number one, they're also not dog trainers. Again, this is not anger, this is passion because I'm sick and tired of 5 million dogs being killed, okay? Now, this is where we are today. And let me get a really good close-up on this. Okay, this is where we are today.
Outside with her, so she gets some freedom and she gets some fun. So
John is conditioning her to put the collar on because she wants to. So watch.
Yep. So I'll keep going.
Collar goes up.
Yes.
Head goes through the collar. Gives food. Look at this dog's energy.
Now I'll do collar.
Calls it collar.
Yes.
The dog is voluntarily putting its head through the thing. He's using food.
Yes. Good girl.
Okay. How's the relationship collar. Look, folks?
Yes.
How's the relationship look between John and this dog?
Collar. Yes.
How's the energy of this dog look?
Collar. Yes. Good girl.
I don't even think the dog's wearing a leash. In fact, collar. The dog is not even looking wearing a leash. John will do this probably 250
yes,
times. What he's doing is he's saying the word collar.
Yes.
And the dog is putting its head through the collar. Okay?
Collar.
Same dog, a little bit more than 1 week later. Probably 7 training days.
Collar. Collar. Yes. Good girl. Collar.
Okay. Look at how calm that dog is. Look at how that dog is not being pushy or snotty. This is unedited video.
Yes.
So this is the raw video that I get in.
Honestly,
do you see it?
She's a small dog.
Do you see that? So this is unedited video that I get in. I haven't edited it yet. The only thing I've done is I've increased the volume from 100% to 400%. Other than that, I have done nothing at all. Look at this dog. So, that dog was corrected at a high level on a remote collar to stop the dangerous behavior. Okay, now look at the dog. Proof is there. We do this every day. Again, I'm not mad, I am not angry, I am not yelling. This is anybody that knows me, this is passionate Jeff. As soon as I saw this video, I said to myself, I'm gonna get it on Periscope. I looked up the first video, found this, read the history of the dog, and then saw this video, and I wanted to share this with everybody even before I edited the video because I felt it was so important that people understand that in a little bit more than a week's time, that's the change we got. That dog, I'm not sure how old that dog is, but probably they've been living with us for years. It doesn't make a difference. And I will go into why the dog. Yes, you can go to, right to correction. You absolutely can. Absolutely. You have to. You have to. You actually have to. You have to correct the dog. You've got to stop. Okay, if there was somebody, okay, imagine this. Are we ready for this? All right, I've been sober for over 20 years. Okay, imagine this. Somebody is drunk. Somebody is on heroin. They're in the middle of the street, a busy street, yelling and screaming and swearing and kicking cars. What would you do? What would you do to that person? If you were a police officer, what would you do? What would you do? What's your job? What is the job of a police officer to do? Is to serve the community. This is not, don't, you know, I'm a big fan of cops, so please don't be bashing police officers, okay? So it is, you have to stop that person. You have to stop, thank you. You have to, it's actually probably been more than 20 years by now. You have to stop that person. You tackle them, you handcuff them, you drag them off the street, you throw them in the back of the police car. When the ambulance arrives, you strap them to a gurney, you take them to the emergency room. Okay? You might have to knock them out, right? You might have to give them a sedative. You might have to taser them. I'm not saying remote collars are like tasers. I'm giving an example. You have got to stop the dangerous behavior. You've got to stop the dangerous behavior. Now, next morning. Do you know where you are? Do you know what you were doing last night? Do you even remember? You know what? We're going to put you in a program. We're going to put you in a program and we're going to teach you how to be a better human being. Because not only are you causing pain and suffering to yourself, you're causing pain and suffering to others. And if you don't keep it up, you will be dead. And you also might harm somebody else. Okay? There you go. That's my Periscope for tonight. I'm super passionate about the work we do. I'm super passionate about the work we do. That's why I yell, I scream, even though I don't yell and scream. Okay, but that's why I do the work I do. That's it. That's why I'm on a soapbox so much, because I know we can fix this word, this behavior, and I am telling you, it takes a correction to do it. All right? Awesome, guys. Thank you so much. The best thing people can do with this is share this. Little character on the corner, all right? And don't just share it. Write a little thing when you share it. So you write something in there while you share it. All right? Do you have videos? I've got lots of, we show corrections all the time. I'm one of the few dog trainers that has the balls to show a correction. I use a remote collar, dressage whip, leash correction. Absolutely. Absolutely. We show corrections. Not too many dog trainers will show corrections because they're afraid of the hate. They're afraid of the hate. I don't care if you like us, you know, I can care less. I can care less if people like me or not. What do I care? You know? So that's it, guys. That's it. So share this, invite people, join me, follow me. I'll be back in Rhode Island on Tuesday. John's on vacation next week. I've got a shadow student coming in. Next week. I've got an RV dog trainer next weekend. I've got some audit spots available for that. I've got a shadow person coming over from Europe, spending a week with me. There's a lot of great stuff. We're going to be making so many videos. It hasn't been confirmed yet, but I've got a 90-pound German Shepherd that loves to bite people's faces off. We don't know if the dog, it's an emergency situation, we're getting them in. Nobody can even handle this dog. They don't even know how they're going to get the dog to us. They don't even know how they can get the dog to us. That's the dogs that we work with. Those are the dogs we work with. So I would consider that actually an average to lighter dog, just to give everybody, to scale the kind of work that we do. So when people criticize us, I'm always like, come and play. Come and play in my arena. All right, come on and play in my arena. Go ahead. Yeah, so, all right, guys. No anger, no yelling, mad passion, though. I love this stuff. Yeah, we document. So, Leanna, we make videos of every single dog that we work with. We take photos, we make videos, we document. Now that Periscope is here, the Periscope session for cops and how to approach dogs. Actually, I might disagree with you a little bit on that. I would disagree on that. I mean, yes, everyone should be a little bit knowledgeable, but I've got a great example of the thing is the police are shooting dogs, and I don't want to get political about this. They're actually shooting less dogs. We just have more social media right now. Statistically, they're shooting less dogs, but I don't think it's a police officer's job to read dogs, and I'll tell you why. Most dog trainers can't, these are professional dog trainers, they can't read dog body language. They work with dogs every day. And now you're asking a police officer to understand dog body language. I think that it's up to the police officer to serve and protect the human and the community. And I'll give you one example about that. I don't want to get off track, but my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. You know, getting off track might as well be my middle name. I actually don't have a middle name, right? Talk to my mom about that. So, Matt, this is the example that I like to give people. All right. A police officer gets a phone call. Domestic violence. One of the number one phone calls that police officers get are domestic violence, at least in Providence, Rhode Island, where I am. I've got many police officers as clients. All right? Many police officers as clients. So they get a domestic, they'll get a domestic violence phone call, where somebody will call and they'll say, I'm being threatened and my kids are being threatened by my husband. He has a weapon. Okay? So, officer gets there. He's been alerted that it's domestic violence. He's been alerted that a weapon is involved. He's been alerted that somebody is afraid for their lives and there are children in the house. This is a very, very normal situation. Okay? Normal situation. Okay? Now, officers entering the yard. He hears from the yard, I'm going to kill you and your kids. Now, that probably is happening because the person that's in there with the weapon is in a high state of rage and it made somebody call 911. A dog is in the yard and approaches the police officer. What does the police officer do? What does the police officer do? Seriously, I'm sorry, they have to neutralize the threat. I would not want that police officer to even wait one more second to think. I want that police officer in that home as quick as possible. It sucks. Yep, it sucks. It really sucks. There's no winners. So, what I say is, this is the best way for things to happen, is this. Don't be the person, don't be the family, don't be the home, don't be the human being that needs a police officer to come to your house for domestic violence. That's it. I'm done. I'm not going to even get into it any farther because I went way off track. Way off track. All I'm saying is most dog trainers can't read dogs. So you're asking a police officer to start reading dogs? That's a lot. But bottom line is this. I'll give you one more example. Why? Because my middle name is Off Track Gellman. I'm walking my dogs. And an off-leash dog comes racing at me. I neutralize that dog. There you go. It doesn't make a difference. The dog's a threat. It's a threat. I don't take out a gun and shoot the dog. But I make sure it doesn't get to my pack. I start out with verbal. I'm really good at reading intention, but still, I don't even want a happy-go-lucky dog coming at me because it can be a dog fight because my dogs are on leash. All right, anyway, way off track. Let's focus on Let's focus on the first 90% of what I had to say today. All right, guys. But somebody did want me to do a Periscope on how to stop off-leash dogs. So that'll be another Periscope. I'll do that one tomorrow. All right. May I be in love with you, Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. We'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.